My name is Ricardo Melendez Ortiz. I'm the head of ICTSD in Geneva. It's really a great pleasure to welcome you to this meeting, to this event, where we're going to look into the trade and climate change linkages post-Paris, and in which, in an era that some people are already calling also post-2016. And then I'm really delighted to have the panel that we have with us at this meeting. I'll be introducing them as we go through their speaking slots. Let me just also say that this is an occasion that we had been very keen on putting together since about a year ago. And then we have been finding that developments in the international agenda would make it better for us to postpone it and postpone it. And we thought, okay, that's this is the moment to do it, where we can take a bit more of perspective on developments since the COP21 and Paris, and having gone through what has been a tremendous years of commitment and development on the climate front, with agreements on emissions aviation at ICAO, as well as the agreements that we saw in Kigali with respect to the IHFCs, and the Marrakesh Conference of the Parties, which I couldn't attend, but my colleagues and most of the people in the panel did go to, where again, that commitment to climate action was very much the highlight. We have seen a few changes coming specifically from across the Atlantic on the international commitment to the issue of climate change, but still are expecting that the better angels of ourselves would take over that perspective, and that we actually see a continuation of the commitment. I think the Paris Agreement have signaled change and engagement in the right direction. There's no doubt about that. Nevertheless, we continue to be incredibly concerned with the pace of that change, particularly against the targets that we set ourselves in the international community to maintain the temperature rise at a 2-degree level rather than above this, and looking at the reports that we have from the WMO and other meteorological services, which indicate that 2016 has indeed been the hottest year on record at 1.1 degrees already above pre-industrial levels. So again, one of the big questions we have, the key question, I guess, for this conversation in this place, is whether trade policy can really pick up the urgency of acting on behalf of climate, support that direction of change, and actually help accelerate that pace of reform. The Paris Agreement, as you all know, has been built as a bottom-up architectured world. We are relying on individual national governments to implement their actions, actually to design, then to pledge, and then to implement those actions in conjunction with subnational entities, the business sector, and with all the possible help they can get from the international frameworks. And so that's where we have been sort of warning, and this goes back to the negotiations of the Kyoto Protocol from ICTSD, about the need to ensure that there is good alignment with trade policy, such that when the negative spillovers or the concerns about competitiveness come from the implementation of national policies and measures, the trade regulatory frameworks are then ready to arbitrate and to put in place the right type of agreements, the right type of provisions that would allow countries to move collectively towards that shared objective of pursuing low carbon strategies. We believe that post Paris, or in the context of the Paris Agreement, this is something that is going to become more and more evident. Again, that tension between the adoption and the implementation, particularly of national policies and measures, and the need for the coordination and the right frameworks, again, to govern over the interdependence, the economic interdependence of countries in that setting. In the trade system, and specifically in the WTO, we have been looking in a piecemeal approach to some of the issues related to climate and trade. What is incredibly, again, a slow motion in a way, and without a good comprehensive approach to the problem. We at ICTSD, in the effort that we continue to carry out in cooperation with the World Economic Forum through what is called the E15 initiative, put together a group of experts that look at some of these issues on trade and climate change, and as well as some other aspects of the relationship between trade and climate policy, came up with a series of recommendations under the leadership of James Backus, which are on the table and very much relevant and valid, not only today, but probably as we move forward into looking at these issues. I'll just say, before I turn to the panel, that coming back from Davos and listening to the discussions that leaders have, and the expectation again of the changes that we have seen coming from Washington, it's very encouraging to understand what doesn't seem to be yet very generalized in public opinion, which is that some of the malaise that we have been reflected with respect to globalization and to global cooperation in the electoral politics in North America, and some of that we're seeing in Europe, does not necessarily represent the feelings in the rest of the world. And I think that that's very important as an observation. This is perhaps one of the biggest sort of conclusions that I got from that week of exchanges in Davos, is that there is a very strong commitment in most countries of the world, and I'd say specifically with respect to climate action, with respect to movement on furthering global integration that is responsible, that leads to growth through, again, the low carbon and sustainable paths, and that, of course, we'll have to deal with the challenges that may come from the new administration in Washington and incorporate their concerns into ways of moving forward. But the important point to make there, again, is that there is, in the rest of the world, a very big commitment on these issues. And I'll just finish by saying that for most of the work that we have done with respect to the economics of climate change in a globalized world, it is clear now to many people, including the business community, although we would like to see the business community more sort of with a stronger voice behind these messages, that that innovation, growth, inclusiveness, it's going to come from the pursuit of low carbon strategies, and that it's now clear that high carbon strategies do not generate growth, and certainly not inclusive and sustainable growth. And so, as simple as that seems to be as an observation, it was something that was not there a few years ago. And I think, again, the Paris Agreement has helped us in moving views in that direction. So with that, let me turn to the panel, rather. And as I said, I would be introducing one by one our speakers. We would have some of the remarks made from the floor without some slides, some with slides. And we also have Ambassador Joe Tindall coming through video from New Zealand. And so we will be handling all this as we go along the agenda. I will start with Jim Backus, who is known in the, very well known in this house. I just simply said that James Backus was the first chairperson of the appellate body of the WTO. And probably in that capacity, he had the oversight of decisions that have been fundamental in the integration of the world trade system and the climate change and sustainable development regimes in generating coherence between the two. He's now in private practice with Greenberg Traurig, and is also the chair of the what do you call it exactly in the international
The ICC. I'm chair of the Commission on Trade and Investment.
The Commission on Trade and Investment of ICC.
One of my members is here.
Exactly. And for us, as a great honor, Jim is also a member of the board of ICTSD, of the governing board of ICTSD. So, Jim, we have. We will start with you now. Yes.
Thank you very much, Ricardo, and all. Not to worry, there will be no exam on my resume. These days, I like to point out, I started very young. The first thing I want to do is thank the ICTSD. I appreciate the opportunity to work with Ricardo, Ingrid, and others on the cutting edge of the relationships between trade and sustainable development worldwide, and I very much appreciate the fact that they let me help do some of the cutting, and I look forward to continuing to do so. I'm especially grateful that Ricardo and our friends at the WEF asked me to be one of the ringleaders on the E15 initiative. The easy work of producing thousands of pages of recommendations and empirical evidence supporting them is over. Now the hard work begins of actually getting some of these things done, and that's what I want to talk about briefly today as it relates to trade and climate change. I thought I might summarize the main points of the report we made on our task force on trade and climate change last year, a task force I chaired, and then I'm happy to try to answer any questions later on. The first point that occurred to us, an assembled group of trade-minded, commercial-minded climate experts and climate and environmental-minded trade experts was that the two worlds of trade and climate change were indeed separate worlds. They're separate silos. And that inhibits progress. Last month, the COP met to discuss how they were going to go about the technical aspects of trying somehow to discern what the rightness or the wrongness of response measures to climate change as they affect the economic aspects of development, including trade restrictions. And there was no consensus. The United States reportedly argued, well, this should be done in the WTO, not in the COP. Other countries disagreed. They said it needed to be done in the COP, not the WTO. In my view, and indeed our view on the task force, they're both wrong. It needs to be done by the COP and the WTO together in cooperation. And we urge that they begin to work much more closely together rather than separately with occasional salvos from one to the other. We recommend this in part because, as I've been saying since a speech I gave in Copenhagen nearly a decade ago, the trade and climate regimes are on a collision course. Example, there is no understanding of what a legitimate response measure on climate change might be. We have voluntary national pledges where countries have said what they intend to do on climate change to fulfill their Paris commitments. Let's engage in a law school hypo, which I sometimes do in my classes where I teach. Country A applies a measure that is trade restrictive. Country B says, we're sorry, you can't do that. It's trade restrictions are inconsistent with your WTO obligations. Country A says, no, they're not, because this is a climate measure. This is something we're doing as a legitimate response measure to address climate change. Who decides? Despite our recommendations as legal advisors to the COP on the Paris Agreement, there is no dispute settlement mechanism in the Paris Agreement. If the measure affects trade, it falls within the jurisdiction of the WTO. So the answer to who decides is the WTO will decide. My successors on the appellate body will eventually make the final decision. And in doing so, they will have to do what they try to do, which is clarify WTO obligations in a way that draws the right line. So you'll have WTO judges determining what is and what is not a climate measure. This is not necessarily a bad idea. I would submit that from the beginning, the appellate body has been sensitive to environmental and sustainable development concerns. I'm a bit biased in that respect since I wrote a lot of those opinions. Our point on our task force is this is happening inadvertently. It's happening because we haven't worked together to try to work something out together. If, for example, the COP were to decide and define with exactitude what a response measure is that is legitimate under the climate agreement, then I'm certain that the appellate body would feel bound by that. It happens that every member of the WTO is also a member of the COP. There are many, many other examples of potential collisions. We have recommended another policy approaches that would try to avoid this collision and also use WTO rules affirmatively to try to address climate change in some positive ways. One of our most important recommendations is a very mundane one. We believe there must be common metrics for determining the amount of carbon used or emitted in the making of a product. If there are any trade remedies lawyers here, then you know that it's very, very hard to calculate exactly how much dumping there has been, if any. And trade lawyers traipse all over the world looking at price sheets and invoices of companies to try to determine that. And yet we still have endless disputes and debates within the WTO about this topic after more than half a century. We don't have any idea yet of any common metrics for judging the amount of carbon that there is that is used or that is emitted from the making of a product. The COP is moving in that direction. There are efforts to do so. There, too, I think the WTO should be working alongside them, and there should be a common approach. That is one of our recommendations. In terms of common metrics and a common definition of a climate measure, we then look at the WTO obligations themselves. To what extent must they be changed, we think, to address climate change? Here we had long deliberations because, on the one hand, we're very mindful of the centrality of the notion of a like product to the upholding of the obligation of most favored nation treatment and the obligation of national treatment. two fundamental obligations of non-discrimination that are at the very core of the WTO trading system. We don't want to throw that completely away by any means. We want to maintain that distinction to be able to maintain the trading system. And we fear a Pandora's box if we open up PPMs that are related to the climate without being strict and specific and limited in doing so, because that would be a Pandora's box to pretty much any kind of other supposed distinction that would lead you to the conclusion that two traded products are not like. Instead, we recommend a very specific and limited approach. We see climate change as a unique issue, which deserves a unique treatment in the WTO agreement. And we feel that what is needed is a climate waiver, a waiver that would be determined, defined, and decided by the members of the WTO. Here is one of our options I'd like to read so you know exactly what we're proposing. It's policy option 15. If you look at our report online on the E15 initiative's site, and we say, through a decision by the members of the WTO, provide that a carbon tax or any similar tax based on the amount of carbon used in making a product is an indirect tax on a product that is therefore eligible for border tax adjustment under Article 22A of the GATT. We also suggest that notion of a technical regulation and the definition of technical regulation should be clarified, because we think the word related in that definition ahead of processes and production methods should include the energy used or the carbon emitted in making a product. Furthermore, at the most basic level, in terms of this waiver, We have suggested that the WTO members agree on a waiver from WTO obligations for all trade restrictive climate measures that are based on the amount of carbon used or emitted in making a product and that are taken in furtherance of and in compliance with a UNFCCC climate agreement or with a plurilateral climate club or carbon market. And then we go on to stress that that waiver should include provisions that allow for some but not all WTO members to create climate clubs that can move forward on climate-related issues beyond their current nationally determined contributions to do more to address climate change without running afoul of WTO rules. The same would go for carbon markets and the linkages in carbon markets as contemplated in the UNFCCC and also in the Paris Agreement. Lastly, I would like to note that there are a series of additional suggestions we have had beyond a climate waiver that would enable the WTO obligations to be used more affirmatively to try to combat climate change. Foremost, we have suggested mandating full disclosure of fossil fuel subsidies under the WTO rules, affirming that fossil fuel subsidies are actionable subsidies under those rules, and agreeing on the gradual phase-out and ultimate prohibition of such subsidies. This is certainly consistent with the Paris Agreement and the UN Sustainable Development Goals. We have also suggested that an uncertainty in the current jurisprudence be clarified by specifying that Article 20 of the GATT applies to the Agreement on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures so that subsidies intended to support climate action may deviate from the general obligations. Although our task force did not address the issue, other E15 task forces went beyond this to endorse a suggestion that Rick and I and others have made in many places for a sustainable energy trade agreement that would include a carve-out for carefully defined green subsidies from subsidies obligations. Just a couple of more points. We recommended that we ban binational government procurement and permit only non-discriminatory purchases of climate-friendly environmental goods and services under the WTO government procurement agreement. We do not see domestic content requirements as benefiting the environment. The empirical evidence suggests in the main that they do not, and they certainly are needlessly restrictive on trade. We encourage the negotiation and conclusion of high-level standards that are coherent and that are shared in a way that leads us toward harmonization of regulatory commitments worldwide. We encourage tech transfer under the TRIPS agreement to developing countries from developed countries to help enable them to participate fully in the green economy. And lastly, we have urged more action on aviation and shipping emissions, two matters that were really left out of the climate agreement and left to the ICAO and the IMO. Here we note the there has been progress since Paris on air emissions from aviation, and there is some small movement forward on marine emissions from shipping as well. There needs to be much more. I wanted to address my time to summarizing our recommendations. As we move into questions and answers, I'll be happy to delve a little bit more into the depth if you wish me to do so. I would also like to point out that it is not only in developing countries that there is a commitment to addressing climate change. Do not be deceived by all of what is tweeted in the world. Most Americans are very much in favor of addressing climate change in a positive, affirmative, and immediate way. I am just one of them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jim. That's it's very specific, and as you see, there's a very heavy but incredibly important agenda that we see for the WTO in this respect. I think, as Jim said before, and because he has taken that line of focusing on the E15 options and proposals, and there is also a set of issues that we have dealt with through other initiatives in the E15 and in ICTSD. And more importantly, perhaps, is obviously the question of liberalization of environmental goods and services, particularly climate friendly technologies, and among them, specifically, the issue of clean energy technologies. And so we all know where we stand on that negotiation of a plurilateral. We're hoping that, as one of our former colleagues and now a Finnish negotiator just wrote in our webpage this morning, we're in a standstill, or rather in a standby, on those negotiations, and that standby could help us try to understand also how to move forward, not only to include liberalization at the border, but going to services, non-tariff buyers, and other issues that would be very important in clean energy technologies. I'll turn immediately now to a view that would give us a very good briefing of what's happening in the climate change front. We will have two views indeed. One will come from Ambassador Joe Tyndall, who is currently the chairperson of the ad hoc working group on the Paris Agreement. Previously, she was for seven years the climate change negotiator for New Zealand with Tim Grossard, and before that, probably familiar in this house as a trade negotiator. And so Joe, instead of traveling here, has recorded her intervention, and so we'll listen to that. And immediately after that, turn to our colleague, Andre Marco. For us, it's a great honor to work with Andre. I'll introduce Andre properly after Joe's intervention. And Andre will complement specifically on issues related to what is called Article 6, that really touches on the core of some of the issues of the relationship between trade and climate change and the two regimes. So let's go now with the intervention from Joe Tyndall.
I'm sorry not to be able to be at this event in Geneva, but this is, I hope, a good second best. The Paris Agreement on climate change, I think, changes everything. And I say that because it's the first time both developed and developing countries are undertaking to reduce their emissions on the same footing. All parties are agreeing to act, and it's no longer a case of some sort of us and them approach to climate change. To get that agreement, though, the hallmark of the Paris Agreement is building in diversity. And by that, I mean diversity of national circumstances and therefore of responses to climate change. And also building in flexibility, recognising the widely different capacities amongst parties to the agreement. The Paris Agreement, as we know, has a number of legally binding provisions that are focused on the requirements to take a nationally determined contribution, an NDC, requirements to report transparently and regularly, to adhere to so-called modalities, procedures and guidelines, MPGs, and to be reviewed multilaterally on a regular basis. As many parties have said, and in fact many commentators have said, and I believe, climate change is fundamentally an economic issue, not only an environmental one. And the Paris Agreement, together with the more than 190 NDCs that sit alongside it, mean governments are now facing up to what this means in practice. How will they deliver on those NDCs? What will their 2050 strategy for a long-term low-emissions pathway look like? And I think everyone's in agreement that it sets the path on a global economic transformation that is truly significant. Now, we have a little under 2 years to December 2018 to write the so-called Paris rulebook. Those modalities, procedures and guidelines underpinning the agreement itself. And that's a big challenge for the ad hoc working agreement, working group on the Paris Agreement, the APA, which I co-chair currently. And at its heart, that process of writing the rulebook is about where and how to place the boundaries around the flexibility implied by an agreement based on national determination in light of different circumstances. Now, the rules are going to need to accommodate diversity and facilitate capacity building amongst developing countries. But at the same time, they're going to need to give confidence by having clarity and consistency, all the same kinds of things that are essential to underpin the international rule of trade law. And I think in the time I've got, I just wanted to go through what some of those questions are going to be, where the intersection with between trade and climate change is going to lie. First, I think that diversity of NDCs will mean that competitiveness concerns remain relevant. For example, will fairness or comparability be informally assessed despite the national determination that underpins the agreement? And if so, how? And with what consequences? There are clearly going to be questions around the potential for international transfers of mitigation outcomes, IPMOs, or the trading, if you like, in carbon markets. How is that going to work if one party to a trade doesn't have a carbon budget or a quantified NDC? The MPGs are going to be necessary to ensure environmental integrity and to avoid double counting. They're going to set standards for transparency, for accounting, and they're going to underpin the international transfers, the ITMOs. I think another area of interest is the compliance regime, the compliance mechanism and committee under the Paris Agreement, which is very clearly going to be facilitative and non-punitive. Unlike the WTO, there will be no comparable dispute settlement procedures or provisions. And it's been interesting that to date there have been very few climate change related cases brought to dispute settlement in the WTO context. Is that going to stay the same, or will it change as a result of the Paris Agreement? And I think it's something we have to think about. In terms of domestic policies, the Paris Agreement should encourage governments to look for clearer policy alignment and to kind of mainstream climate change into their economic development strategies and agendas. We've noted with interest in New Zealand that several NDCs, quite a number of them, referred to phasing out fossil fuel subsidies. And given the importance of getting price signals to producers and consumers right, that is going to be, I think, quite an important move. And a big challenge is going to be how to quantify the mitigation impact of phasing out those subsidies and to build that into NDCs. Of course, again, the flip side of phasing out fossil fuel subsidies is putting a price on carbon. And it's quite clear that we're going to see that trend, which has already been gaining some momentum, increase quite significantly under the Paris Agreement. I think it's around a quarter to a third of NDCs indicated the government's intention or at least retaining the possibility, the option, of using international carbon markets to help meet their targets. And that's critical to help leverage ambition and also to promote significant investment in clean energy technology and infrastructure in developing countries. So it's a trend we're going to see increase. And I could wax lyrical on that subject for quite some significant time, but I'm just going to touch on it, given where we are today. Article 6 of the Paris Agreement, which deals with carbon market issues and international transfers, isn't on the APA agenda, but it is linked by means of the accounting and transparency work that the APA has to achieve. Of course, it creates this new concept of ITMO and also lays the foundations for a new market mechanism to be developed, where the UNFCCC itself would be generating units. There is going to need to be quite intensive work to flesh these provisions out. And we know that diversity is the key word here too. As different countries develop their own emissions trading schemes or offsetting or crediting mechanisms, they are doing so in ways that are tailored to their individual national circumstances. And we're going to have to work things out in a way that takes that into account. Learning from the past, lessons from the CDM, for example, and accommodating that range of different systems while still developing a code of conduct to allow the market to function with confidence and credibility. We're not going to have in this new world such a clear-cut binary categories of buyers and sellers. And those divisions will become even more blurred in the future. I think it's in everybody's interest to anticipate and address the tough questions now. If we leave it entirely to the market, then it might well sort itself out, but it will be a laborious, long-winded, and very fragmented process. So I see the Paris Agreement, the rule book that we're negotiating, and the NDCs that underpin the agreement as an opportunity to take the trade and the environment into the 21st century. While the two sides haven't exactly fought against each other, it's fair to say there's a basis now for them to work with much better synergy. And we've started to see multiple examples of economic growth being sustained or indeed improved despite or perhaps because of actions that governments have taken on climate change. The time is really ripe to mainstream it and to get our respective multilateral fora to be and frameworks to be mutually supportive. So thank you for the opportunity to speak today and to join you virtually.
Thank you to Ambassador Joe Tindall. I think she said, as I said before, she chaired the ad hoc working group of the Paris Agreement. It's really the lead of the efforts to ensure that now implementation in a very detailed manner. Now, I'd like to turn immediately to Andre Marco. And as I said, Andre is currently senior fellow with ICTSD on issues related to climate change. Specifically, he leads two initiatives that he has himself started, and it's the energy behind. One is on Article 6, which he'll talk a bit more, and which has been introduced in a way by Joe very, very lightly. And then a European roundtable and on a transition to sustainable development that we co-sponsor from ICTSD. So Andre, and I should say Andre is probably well known here and to people around the world as the founder and first president and CEO of the International Emissions Trading Association, also with a long career in the business sector. Being a vice president of Mercuria Trading here in Geneva, as well as working with the World Business Council on Sustainable Development, among many others. So, Andre, please, you now have the floor.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ricardo. It's a pleasure to be here and working with you and Ingrid and colleagues in ICTSD. One thing that I said is first time I came into this building used to be the UN Library. That dates you a little bit, but that's when I went to school, and like Jim, I started very early. But one thing that I think Ricardo hasn't mentioned, but because probably I have so many hats that sometimes I get confused, is the fact that I also chair or facilitate the contact group on response measures in the UNFCCC negotiations. So, you know, some of the echoes that you heard, I had to painfully try to mediate in some way, and now we're in the process of putting together a reflection note for the next session, and that is another very political and painful thing, trying to convince people that you're writing a reflection note and not a summary of the meeting. Now, I kind of try to go at it about in a Cartesian way, so if you a few seconds here to go through the Kyoto Protocol, which was caps, timetables, mechanisms, and compliance, to me it was very Cartesian. For the people across the water here at Mercuria, it made perfectly sense because it adds and subtracts, and we all understood how it works from a trade point of view, especially from a carbon market point of view. The Paris Agreement is if you want, you know, as the Brazilian would say, it's a mess. And it's because it's NDCs and transparency. And the Paris Agreement, basically, it's a promise. It's a promise that we will do well and that we trust each other and that we will increase our level of ambition over the years. But it's a promise. And frankly, you know, I mean, looking at what's happening right now, obviously, coming from Marrakesh, we heard the chorus of people very encouraging each other and being very hopeful that we all move together, but one should take the United States and the president in a very serious way. So we are watching with a lot of trepidation what's happening across the water. Now, the important thing is that both of these things introduce an asymmetrical climate change policy, in the sense that if you on the KP, the Kyoto Protocol, was seen as being a top-down agreement. Frankly, I was in Kyoto. I don't remember it as being. I remember it as a Canadian wanting to do 1% more than the Americans. So in a way, it was a pledge, and we all pledged what we could. Now, in here, it's a lot looser, but it is essentially a decentralized system where people make their own pledges, and then we hope at the end it's going to add up to 1.5 or 2 degrees. But the asymmetry continues and will continue to exist. There's just no way that different economies with very different profiles is going to be so easy to understand what is an equal level of effort. The other thing that I think has been repeated, and I'll repeat it again, if you look through the Paris Agreement and the Kyoto Protocol, yes, it is an environmental agreement, but it essentially is an economic agreement on the basis of environmental scarcity. So what does the Paris Agreement do? The Paris Agreement basically tries to understand what does my competitor do and how does he do it? So it is all about transparency. You say what you're going to do, and then you have a transparency provision so anybody understands how you do it. So you have to all kind of provisions, many of them to be defined. And then how does he do it? Because if I do it with some very easy to, if BASF in Germany does it with some very easy credits from some place in the world, and the Japanese doing some very high quality credits because, you know, that's the way they look at things, then the EU allows certain credits, Japan allows different type of credit, then somebody's going to pay more as we go along. Carbon pricing happens to be just the most visible kind of type of asymmetry. Some countries have, or some regions have, carbon pricing, like the EU has been experimenting with this and moving on with this now for more than a decade. Others are new. Korea is new. Quebec, California, others are maybe coming behind it. But it's just one. Now, in terms of the price and the cost, so we have a price for carbon, but the important, the price is really not that relevant. The important, the relevant price, the relevant element is the cost. What is the cost and who pays that cost? Because everybody is in the EU emission trading scheme is for paying a, having a high price of carbon, of the right price of carbon, a relevant price of carbon, but most people say they can't pay, because they are in an in a globalized industry and not everybody has this. The reality is that right now this is an issue, competitiveness as a result of climate change, but it's not a real issue. If we, and we're not speaking now as a result of getting out of bed this morning, it's as a result of studies that I've done and working in Brussels now for the last 5 years. And Ricardo's right. I've been in business in terms of being doing policy for business, and I see some of my former colleagues here, the Business Council. But I, for the last 5 years, I kind of reformed myself and started, you know, working in think tanks and started writing and researching. It's a lot of fun to do this. But doing this research, we found out that really in the first two phases of the emission trading scheme in Europe, most industry have been positive, in the sense that the bottom line of getting free allocation has been a plus. There's very few industries that have been in the minus. The ones that have been in the minus have been essentially electro-intensive industries, people like electric arc steel or aluminum. These guys have had about 12% of the bottom line in CO2 cost. Now, what will happen in the future is a completely different story, but that's different. Now, the other thing that I want to preface is by saying that the measures to address competitive pressure as a result of climate change measures, so we'll make a difference between the response measures, which are carbon pricing, and the one that I like and know better, and the impact of response measures, which is the impact of those measures. So those impacts, to alleviate the negative impacts that you don't want, such as carbon leakage, are being addressed now at the national level. It's essentially, the preferred element is free allocation. And it's, we've seen it in Europe, we've seen in California and Quebec, Australia when it was about to have one. So it is all over the place, it's free allocation. Border carbon adjustments are an option right now. You know, we see in the phase four emission trade, EU emission trading scheme, the option of potentially having a border carbon adjustment that essentially is a cement provision. It's written in such a way that really is for cement and lime. But really, if you keep having it at a national level, you cannot continue to do this forever, because the curve goes down, and there's only so many free allowances that you can give. And by the mid-2020s, 25, 26, 27, you're going to start running out of free allocation. So that is not a long-term solution. Now, coming to the Paris Agreement, it has a number of provisions that connect directly with trade and competitiveness. One is Article 415, the impact of response measures to climate change. So what Article 415 and the Paris Agreement and response measure deals with the impact of response measures. How do you deal with the negative impacts, pretty much? And the second one is Article 6, which is an article that deals with cooperative approaches, markets and non-markets. Now, Article 6, really, everybody talks of it as being the markets thing. And it is markets thing because this is, it came out of the stream of negotiations and negotiators, which were markets. That's where it came from. And it has a non-market piece to it because there were a number of countries, especially the ALBA countries, Nicaragua, Bolivia, Venezuela, Cuba, that really insisted that it has to be a balance between markets and non-markets. Well, balance sometimes makes sense, sometimes doesn't make sense, but in this case, it had to be that way. And we ended up with a provision in Article 6 about 70% talking about what is essentially markets part of the article. And the last two pieces, Article 6.8 and 6.9, talks about non-market. But the ethos of the whole Article 6 is about international cooperation. What it does in 6.1, it recognizes international cooperation in general to meet the national commitments. Recognizes in 6.2 and 6.3, recognizes international cooperation which involves transfer in the decentralized governance. What that means is that you will essentially have two parties or a number of parties, I think what Jim referred to clubs, climate clubs or market clubs, getting together and forming their own rules. Now, those rules have, in UN parlance, a number of shells. Those rules have to respect, have to promote sustainable development, respect environmental integrity, and be in accordance with some guidelines that the CMA will develop with respect to double counting. Those are the shells. How those shells will translate in reality is a very, very difficult thing to say, because we're really at the point where we really haven't started negotiating these things. Since Paris, and including Marrakesh, it's been a discussion, a very sterile discussion about process and procedures. The UNFCCC, I'm not familiar with other negotiating process in the UN, but UNFCCC in principle works by we will discuss a lot of things, and when there's an inflection point like the Paris Agreement or the 2018 stocktaking, then we have a decision and everybody makes an effort. This is kind of how it works. Now, the other part of Article 6 is one that also recognizes transfers, but recognizes the transfer under a centralized governance. So this is what we would call, for those of you who are familiar with this, would be a successor, in a loose way, a successor to CDM, meaning that the UNF, the CMA, the parties, will make the rules for what the transfers are. So if you are a party, you essentially can kind of choose to work with other parties under Article 6.2, in which you make your own rules. You have to be transparent about it. You have to do a lot of things, but it is your governance. It is a fairly, very much in, the ethos is very much in the hands of the parties. In Article 6.4, you can use that other article and say, well, listen, I'm going to do this under UN rules. Why would anybody choose one or the other? Well, there are a number of parties who really would like to have the blue stamp on their transfers. There are countries in the world in which having the stamp of approval in the transfers, in the quality of the transfers that you use for complying with the UN, with the Paris Agreement, is worth something. For others, it is less relevant, and they would prefer to the freedom to make their own rules. It doesn't mean that they exist in a vacuum. It doesn't mean there is no UN supervision of any sort. But that supervision is very, very non-intrusive, if you want. It's very much about transparency, telling people what you do, but not being held accountable or being told that you can't do it. Now, what does Article 6 do for you? Article 6, with respect to competitive pressures, can do a number of things. It really creates the framework. It doesn't create a market, but it allows for transfers and allows for transfer to count towards NDCs. So what it does, it creates the framework for a carbon market. Doesn't create a carbon market, create a framework for a carbon market. Creates the framework indirectly through a carbon price, a global carbon price. How that carbon price would come about, I mean, who knows? Is it going to be start as small clubs? Is it going to start as, based on economic agreements, a NAFTA club, an East Asian club, that then merge and they link? I mean, there are many models that we can look at it, but one of the important contributions of Article 6 is that it could provide a one price of carbon, which in everybody's dream will equalize the level of effort and everybody will be happy. Now, the other thing that you could do, and Joe and I think Jim referred to this, is the fact that you will have very different type of carbon pricing models. And if you start producing units from different carbon pricing models with very different level of effort, because it's difficult to compare the levels of effort, then you cannot really tell whether my unit is worth a ton and your unit is not worth a ton. That kind of discussion really has not happened, and it's seen as a very, if you want, esoteric discussion right now. But in my view, and the World Bank is doing work on the network carbon market, and it's in the concept of having different units as different currencies with exchange rates between them. Complicated, but possible. And I think it has the merit that instead of linking with a snapshot and you're equal, you're linking two systems by comparing and bringing them the same level of effort, and then systems or countries, economies start moving in different ways, and you have a real problem because that level of effort is not the same, and you have to reset it all the time, renegotiate. You have exchange rates, and that allows you to keep, not have to worry about this equilibrium. The last thing that that Article 6 does for you is this 6.A, 6.9, which is called non-market approaches, that nobody knows what really it is. But everybody wants to be helpful and bring countries that are doubtful about markets as part of Article 6. But I see them as very important because I believe that Article 6.8 and 6.9 are really about cooperative approaches that are of a non-market measure, and this could be a cooperative approach that deals with the things that you referred, Jim, to, things like border carbon adjustment in a cooperative way, not a punitive way. And I believe that in the future, this is where we're going to go out. I am not a WTO person. I cannot speak to many of the things that you speak so eloquently. But instinctively, well, I'm hoping by hanging around with Ricardo and Ingrid, I'm going to get into this. But anyway, we've made the point in the UNFCCC. Right now, it's kind of, you mentioned this, and people kind of, pretend not to hear you. That's the reality where we are. Now, Article 415, which is the article that says that you will recognize the impact of response measures, especially on developing countries. Now, it's a one-liner. And then it has this accompanying decision that says that you will develop a work program and modalities and procedures and so on. But as a history, this was focused on developing countries, transborder impacts of response measures, from a developed country, how does it impact the developed country? And it's very much, the history of it is very much an OPEC issue. It has been in the past an OPEC issue that OPEC wanted compensation for essentially not pumping oil. Ecuador tried that with their national park project. It didn't go very far. I think they wanted $1 billion, and I think they ended up with about $50 million in the kitty or something like that. So it's an interesting idea, but it doesn't work. Now, what it is right now it's moved on, and it's moved on in a number of directions. One direction is, and I'm telling you because I'm writing the paper on the reflection paper, one of them is that it's being seen more and more as a, if you wish, as a component of managing a transition to a low-carbon economy. Response measures, what we're going through right now, the theory is that what we're going through right now is a transition. There's been many transitions. The latest one we've seen, transition from a centrally planned economy to a market economy in Central Eastern Europe. Badly managed, unmanaged in many cases. We don't want to see this. This is a much bigger thing. Response measures is part of that kind of element. The other part is that everybody is being affected right now. And as such, what we are looking at is different levels. We are not looking only at transborder, meaning that what's happening in the EU, how it affects North Africa, but we're looking at what's happening in, if you want, at the sectoral level, at the national level, at the international level. So if you look at in the EU, you see carbon pricing, that affects the competitiveness of Solvay because it's going to affect the, if you want, the price of soda ash globally, and that impacts at the same time the production of flat glass in North Africa. So there are those kinds of impacts. The other very interesting thing, this has been seen as a national thing, but more and more we also look at international measures. And if you look at ICAO, it's a very classic one. Is this going to affect tourism in Costa Rica? there've been, you know, there's not a lot of work on that. We've done some, but there's not a lot of work in this. I think the classical one that I've seen is in the UK done. Some environment committee of the parliament has done some work on carbon taxes for aviation because it was affecting the Caribbean community's ability to go back home for Christmas. Right now, it's not an issue because the carbon price is at 450 or 520, so it doesn't really matter. But if you start getting 30 euros a ton, then it's become a problem. The people that have been preoccupied with this in general have been, most of them have been in the affected by tourism. EOSIS has been very impacted, very interested in this. The Maldives, in the case of the Maldives, the high-end tourism. I'm not quite sure they are that affected, but nevertheless, it's important. Now, what I wanted to say is, you know, frankly, is where Jim left it, is that when we get into the UNFCCC and response measures, the answer for many parties, and as facilitator, I'm not going to name parties, is that, we don't do this here. There's another place which is specialized and has a mandate to do this. And then you look around the room, and there are a few negotiators that know trade. Joe Tyndall happened to be one of them. I think there were a few other ones. But by and large, these are Ministry of Environment people. They are not trade people. They don't, you know, they just not specialize in this. And second thing, they don't have a mandate for this. So it has been, to be fair, and I think it will continue to be for a while, a process-oriented discussion in the response measure part of the UNFCCC. I think the deadlock is going to have to be broken through some kind of a discussion and cooperation with the WTO and UNFCCC. But clearly, this is the future. Why I look at the future of the issue, why I looked at the two things, because I'm a markets guy. My background is carbon markets. I just happened to be asked to do something about carbon leakage in Europe, so I do two big studies. And then by looking all of a sudden through UNFCCC response measures, through a certain total fluke, I started finding things that we were talking in Europe about in terms of competitiveness, carbon leakage, border carbon adjustment. And I said, wait a second, this is the same thing, but these people don't talk to each other. So there's work being done. The work is very disparate, and I think ICTSD is superbly placed to bring this thing together and, you know, take the lead on it. Thank you, Ricardo.
Thank you very much, Andre. That was a very comprehensive presentation. It doesn't escape me, of course, that for people that are not following the climate change negotiations closely, language, obviously, it's always an issue, as it is an issue in the UNFCCC, as you just mentioned, when you speak about trade. And we need to get better at doing the translation. And so that's one reason why I'm very happy you're working with us, and that we are having this panel and this event now. There are many issues that come out of your presentation that we need to follow up on. Let me, for the moment, move on to Ambassador Choi before we get into a debate. We'd like to hear from Ambassador Choi more of a trade perspective, trade policy perspective on some of these issues. Ambassador Choi is also an old hand in Geneva, being this his second or third time in Geneva, as I recall, and with a very long experience on trade negotiations at the bilateral, at the regional, and at the multilateral level. Let me also use the opportunity to thank Ambassador Choi for facilitating that we organize this meeting at the WTO today, and the mission of Korea. And in doing that, also I was remiss from not recognizing before my colleague Ingrid Jago and Sonia Hawkins and the team at ICTSD that have actually organized this meeting. I'm just a passenger, as always, on these issues here. So Ambassador Choi, we turn the floor to you.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. And thank you for organizing this event and inviting me to speak. I was invited to provide some insights from the perspective of trade on the issue of climate trade nexus. But rather than trying to give insights in my presentation, I'd like to focus on what has taken place in the WTO on the issue of trade and environment, and what in my opinion, will most likely to happen in the immediate future. I tried to do this because, in the first place, I'm not a very insightful person. And secondly, I think to have an accurate understanding of the current state of play should be the first step to exploring ways forward. So in the WTO, actually, environment is not a new issue. As you may know, the Marrakesh Agreement establishing the WTO has already in its preamble reference to sustainable development and asked the members try to protect and preserve the environment. And the Doha Ministerial Declaration that was adopted in 2001 to launch the Doha multilateral trade negotiations has two paragraphs relating to environment. One paragraph, paragraph 31, mandates negotiations on first the relationship between multilateral environment agreement and WTO agreement, and second, market access negotiations for environmental goods and services. The next paragraph asks the Committee on Trade and Environment of the WTO to engage in some works relating to trade and environment, including the analysis of impact, or market impact of environmental measures, and also labeling requirement for environmental purposes. So WTO has engaged in activities dealing with trade and environment. In the CT, in the Committee on Trade and Environment, there have been diverse discussions according to the mandate of the WTO agreement as well as Doha Ministerial Declaration, including in recent days briefings about the progress in the climate change negotiations, and also briefings by a few members about how they are going to implement the Paris Agreement. And in the as a part of Doha negotiations, there was negotiations on environment, focusing on market access and also the relationship between the MEAs and the WTO. And last but not the least, we have been seeing increasing number of trade dispute cases involving environmental measures. Especially in recent years, we are seeing a conspicuous increase in cases relating to renewable energies. But all in all, I think it is fair to say that this interface in the WTO has not led to a major changes either in the rules of the WTO or the way WTO address the issue of trade and environment. The discussions at the Committee on Trade and Environment have been very useful, but basically they are information exercise. And the Doha negotiations, it became, I think, quite apparent at the early stage that it is not going to be easy to get some traction for these negotiations, partly because the market access negotiation side, there was a broader negotiations on market access for manufactured products and services in other parts of the negotiations. And also it was very difficult to determine the hierarchy between the WTO agreements and environmental agreements. In the disputes, I think the panels and the appellate body have generally acknowledged the legitimacy of measures, of environmental measures that had trade impact. But this acknowledgement was made on the condition that the environmental measures follow, stay within the confines of the traditional WTO principles of national treatment and proportionality. And after the Paris Agreement was reached, I don't think the situation has changed a lot. It is worth to note that even after the Paris Agreement was concluded, and many commentators said that this agreement will have a profound impact on the way the WTO works, there has been no dedicated discussions in the WTO on either the relationship between trade and climate change or on the Paris Agreement. A few countries, including Korea, Canada, and Costa Rica, did propose that we have a dedicated discussion on these issues, but no consensus was reached. I think primarily because some oil exporting countries were very much adamant against this idea. And then, unfortunately, the plurilateral negotiations on environmental goods failed to conclude. The original intention was to conclude these negotiations by December last year, and the participants made quite substantial progress in the course of the negotiations, but at the end of the day, they were not able to overcome the level of ambition, the difference in level of ambition between different participants. So we can say that mainstreaming environment in the work of the WTO has not happened yet. I think there are several reasons. Most directly, there is fear of new barriers. As Professor Buckus mentioned, that the issue of a PPM that affects the determination of like products are regarded by many WTO members as Pandora's box. And many members fear that once we allow treating environmentally friendly products versus the products that are not regarded as environmentally friendly, then we will have an opening for other politically sensitive concepts to creep in the WTO, including labor standards and corruption, etc. And there is also a great deal of resistance to introducing new disciplines to measures that are currently allowed in the WTO. I think fossil fuel subsidies is a case in point. A group of countries, primarily New Zealand, has proposed for several years that the WTO introduces a discipline, a new discipline, either banning or restricting fossil fuel subsidies. But again, the proposal has not gained much traction. You can guess why. But behind these direct reasons, I think there is also rather distinct WTO culture in the background. In the first place, WTO is an organization that does not want to work in the abstract. Unless the members see impending or immediate difficulties on the ground, it's very difficult to start new discussions. It's worth to note that since the launch of the WTO, which was more than 20 years ago, we have succeeded in introducing a new set of rules only in one area, which is trade facilitation. And there were attempts to try to start discussions on other issues, including investment, competition, but all these efforts failed. And currently, many members want to discuss the issue of e-commerce or digital economy, which is changing the landscape of world trade in a profound way. But even on issues of this nature, there is a great deal of resistance among the WTO members. And also, I think there is a clear lack of a sense of urgency among the WTO members regarding the need to address the relationship between trade and climate change. As I said, the WTO members do not want to work in the abstract, and unless they see measures by governments that affect trade in direct way, they are not going to start serious discussions. And as some of the previous speakers already said, the Paris Agreement is set up in a way that individual governments are going to devise ways to implement the agreement. And we have not seen yet many concrete plans of how the governments are going to implement this agreement. So what can we expect? In my opinion, in the immediate future, I think the WTO is not going to be very active in introducing new rules relating to environment, including climate change. I said there is a fear of new barriers and the fear of introducing new disciplines, and also there is WTO culture. In addition to this, there is a resistance to start another front in multilateral trade negotiations in the wake of the failure of the Doha ministerial Doha multilateral negotiations. Many members of the WTO, including many developing countries, are still of the view that unless we address the remaining Doha development negotiation issues, it's not appropriate to start multilateral negotiations in another area. And with regard to the prospect of environmental goods negotiations, I think at this stage, all we can say is that the prospect is very uncertain. I don't think the difference in positions among participants are so great, too great to overcome. But we have a new U.S. administration which has yet to give a clear signal on how they will address this kind of negotiations. In the meantime, perhaps we can take some small steps, like asking transparency in implementing NDC from individual members, so that they can report what they are doing to the WTO, including to the Committee on Trade and Environment, and where so that the members can review those measures and discuss. And at the same time, interested members can continue informal dialogues on various issues relating to trade and environment, including climate change. I think that this is not a very pretty picture for people who are interested in environment and climate change. Can we make it change? I think there is there need to be a great push from the outside world, so that the WTO members can start seriously look at these issues. But unless there is a great push or pressure from outside, including from the climate change community, it is not likely that the WTO will take the initiative to establish new disciplines. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Choi, again, and thank you for being very frank and very comprehensive and putting the finger on the difficulties of moving these issues forward in this House. I think there are two of the points, of the several points that you make, that I think would be worth rescuing and also working on them going forward. One is the cost of inaction. So the cost of inaction in the WTO specifically. And I think that we know from the past few years that there are at least three ways in which this is manifested. One is tensions, again, between countries that are then obviously taken to dispute, and that's part of the system. It's not that going to a dispute is a negative, but it takes resources. It is in a way a result of ambiguity or lack of clarity on some of the rules, and particularly it goes to a second manifestation of the cost, which is then is slowing down progress both with respect to the policy innovation as well as with the deployment of new technologies and the movement forward at sort of at the pace that we need. And we have seen this, for instance, in the case of clean energy technologies. So with rules that are more clearly enabling of that rapid and massive scale-up of technologies and its deployment, I think we would probably be in a better situation. And a third manifestation probably has to do with some of the issues that Andre mentioned before, which have to do with also slowing down in discussions and generating sort of a chill effect on negotiations on climate, and so not contributing to resolving, but rather to the lack of resolution of many of the climate issues. There's also obviously outside the question of politics and how some of the unpalatability of trade and global integration for many people has to do with the perceived lack of response of trade institutions and agreements to concerns that people have. So I'd like to rescue particularly that point that you made there on that the question of inaction and then the cost of inaction. Let me turn, if I may, now to Dominique Guéron. And Dominique Guéron is currently the chairperson of the International Chamber of Commerce Energy and Environment Commission in France. previously also a very active person, both in the business sector and with Veolia, specifically one of the largest environmental companies working on water and waste, and an active participant in some of these negotiations on environmental goods and services, for instance, as well as very active in the Paris and Marrakesh processes. So, Dominic, you've got the floor, please.
Thank you very much. I don't have slides, so I will avoid repetitions because many things have been exposed, very relevant things. And I want to point out only some key points connected with the business point of view of this very inclusive issue, as we have seen since the beginning of this meeting. I will start with a simple constatation. Business, I will give example from French business, but from worldwide French companies. And when we speak about French business, it is the same thing than if we speak also about European business. Because, as it has been told, I speak for the French committee of ICC. But from an international point of view, be sure of that. business is very involved in climatic issues, of course, and issues on the search for solutions. But free trade is also a major aspects today for making business. So we don't need to have a very profound thought to constate that there is a link between, that must exist a link between climate action and trade, and of course, free trade. It is impossible, as James Beckus told us some minutes again, to have a silo approach. It should be a nonsense. But when we speak about the connection between climatic action and free trade, sometimes we, and very often, we speak about the nexus. It was in the agenda, the nexus. We must know that nexus is a very frightening word for business. So nexus, it means complexity. It means something which is not very clear. In French, we call it nœud gordien, that we must split. Nexus, it's not a factor of optimism. So it is complex. And that's the question for the business, for the French business, when we face this interface between climatic action and free trade. Business is very, very, you know, very, very strongly involved in climatic action. I will only remember that 6 months before the opening of the COP21 in Paris, before then we had an agreement, 6 months before, French business was in a meeting with the French Foreign Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Laurent Fabius, and he told to the business, what do you intend to put on the table to give strong contributions to the climatic action? We called it the positive agenda, if you remember. And the business was immediately in the course, in the race. But it is not only due to political pressure, no. I want to remind only 3 points, 3 reasons why today it is impossible to make business apart from moral consideration and so on. But from a business point of view, there are 3 very important points which are the justifications of the involvement of the business in climatic action. And, of course, after we will see that business means also free trade. Which kind of contradiction, if there is contradiction? 3 points. Of course, we know that the Paris Agreement is not a binding agreement from a legally point of view. We know. It lies on national contributions, INDCs. But we see all the actors of the business, we see the progressive shaping of a kind of compulsory frame, climatic frame. 3 examples. Maybe you have heard of an initiative which is developed by a foundation which is located in Switzerland, very close to here, Sustainable Infrastructure Foundation, which works with ASEAN Development Bank, Inter-American Development Bank, to make templates to integrate the climatic item criteria in the template. And if you are in phase with the template, your project is easily bankable, very easily bankable. So you have a climatic preference. We can call as we want. The result is here. Second point, maybe you have heard of some countries who have launched thoughts of, and also in France, a bonus. So it is incitative measures, but it's more than incitative. Bonus, a plus, when you answer to public bids, and when you say, in my answer, I give you, who I put on the table, a very friendly climatic initiative. Even if it is not at the beginning in the bid, but you add. And more you add, better is it, you can guess. Well, it's a good thing for the climatic cause, but is it not distortion? I don't know. It's a question. Third reason, it has been on the, I want to come back to this point because it seems for our, the French ICC committee, that it is very, very important in the geopolitical context and maybe the politics context. Business is under very, very strong social pressure. Climatic action is fully part of CSR, corporate social responsibility, as you know. NGOs are very looking for, and so, and so, and so. And I will not add the next political meetings in France and in other parts of Europe. And if we ask public opinion, where is the priority? Protecting environment and fighting against climatic disturbances? Or going on more and more, as usual, in free trade? Excuse me, but it's an issue. We are not very sure of the answer. I'm not The representative, of course, because it is absolutely not the position of ICC, of course. But we must take in account that today in France, we have, according to the polls, 45% of the voters who are on this side. It's not very far from 50. Donc, that's an important point. So, that's the reason why business want to give priority and express its involvement, strong involvement in climatic action. Then, we have the second question, and we'll be brief on the second question. Is there a risk of contradiction between our climatic initiative and climatic rules? Not national, because national rules are declined from international agreements, of course. But there is now a corpus of climatic rules, and we try to avoid that there is a contradiction with free trade rules. Because if there is a confrontation, we are not sure, if we take in account the messages of our stakeholders, of our shareholders, we are not sure at all which will be the winner. Which will be the winner? So it's a real issue. So free trade, and we come back to the cost of inaction, I think. Free trade must, from our point of view, not only give a place to climatic issue, but we must success in sending a message about free trade is not a danger for climatic action. Free trade and friendly climatic actions can coexist. I think it's very important. I will close this intervention with the carbon price case, of course. We have already spoke about the carbon price case, because it's a good example of the nexus, I think. We could find other examples, but it's a good example. Carbon market, I have no slide. I have a map which is very difficult to see, but you see colors. Everywhere where there are colors, there are carbon taxes markets, soit already implemented or under consideration. It comes from the source is the World Bank 2016, so it's very present. So, and of course, it is not sole only the same market, carbon market. Of course not, because from Europe, United States, Asia, it's different. Level of price is different, rules are different. Sometimes it is market, carbon market with subsidies. Sometimes it is with taxes. Sometimes it is with standards, facultative or compulsory standards. It's not the same. And you know that with market in some areas, you know, but we don't have time to explore, but the issue is on the table. We know that it can create leakages, of course. It can also engender climate dumping, of course. But see, on behalf of free trade, you cannot be protected against climate dumping, what happens? Alors, I know, because it is a solution or part of solution, I know that we have the old but always in application Article 20 from GATT, maybe a waiver and so on. But the main message that I wanted to deliver, and I close my speech on this point, it is that for business, there is a real issue. It's not clear. It is important to avoid contradiction because stability, you know, is a very important condition, stability in mind, stability in legislation, stability in regulation. It's a part of good business. So that's very important. And I will find, I will close the speech with kind of joke, if I can, because the issue is at the level, the lowest scale, because when the mayor of Paris decided to stop almost fully the car circulation in the center of Paris, it is a very, very friendly climatic initiative. But is it a restriction for free circulation of people and goods and professional activities? That's the question. So you see, but it's a kind of joke, but you see that at the world scale, as at the small scale of a city, which is not a small city, you have also this kind of paradox. So what we hope from this kind of meeting, and I thank the organizers for the choice of the topic, and we are very happy with James in ICC French committee to work on this topic through a joint working group between ICC France and ICC Monde headquarters. We hope that the issue being clearly defined, we will go to the next step to avoid contradiction and to give a clear response to business. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dominique. Again, that's a very frank and clear message. Most of the Paris Agreement implementation is expected to rely, as I said before, being decentralized and bottom-up on these national determining contributions, but also on the contributions, obviously, of the business sector. And we have seen a great deal of voice from the business sector on their commitment to climate action. But as you said, there's nothing perhaps more important for an investor's decision than clarity and predictability and certainty, and that comes from clear rules. So we take your appeal as a very clear one. I'll turn immediately to Clara Brandi, and Clara is a colleague at the German Development Institute. She's a senior researcher there, focusing mostly on these issues, meaning on trade and sustainable development nexuses. Has worked now for a few years on issues related to SDGs, the 2030 agenda, and climate particularly. And the German Development Institute is our partner in the G20 initiative under the German presidency, and we're very happy to have Clara with us. Clara, you get the floor.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation and for organizing this highly interesting meeting. So I will talk about a trade analysis of climate contributions. Having celebrated the Paris Agreement, it's now time to move towards implementation. As we heard, the Paris Agreement entails a bottom-up approach, and that leads to potentially problematic diversity as Joe Tyndall called it, and asymmetries. Countries are free to determine their own climate targets and instruments and to express them in their nationally determined contributions, the NDCs. In what follows, I will take a closer look at the more than 60 submitted climate contributions in the run-up to the Paris Agreement that take into consideration the domestic situations and circumstances capabilities of these countries. The new climate agreement and the NDCs for sure increase the interactions between trade and climate, and we heard a lot about that already. There is, and that's what Joe Tyndall stressed, there is scope for synergies. There are opportunities for mutual supportiveness. But we also heard that there is a danger of tensions between the trade and the climate regime. So the key question going forward is, how can the potential of trade be harnessed for climate protection? What can we learn from taking a closer look at countries' climate contributions? What kind of trade elements are incorporated into these contributions? To what extent do they feature? And which potentials and pitfalls do they entail for climate protection and the supportiveness of trade and climate going forward? Before I discuss 11 trade elements in the NDCs in more detail, let's start with a bird's eye perspective, looking at trade elements and countries' climate contributions in this map. And if you look at the two darkest shades of orangey red, then you'll see all the countries that refer to trade in one way or another in their climate contributions. And if you want to take a closer look at this map and the underlying data, you're welcome to check out the NDC Explorer, which can be found online, which includes more information on the specific trade elements that can be found in these contributions. Looking at all different climate contributions, around 45% of them do refer to trade in one way or another. 22% include more specific trade elements that are in some way or another geared towards fostering mitigation. The largest emitters, however, do tend to be not among them who feature specific trade elements in that way. Almost all contributions, on the other hand, include references to some sort of trade-related elements that are in one way or other relevant for trade. And let me now go through to 11 elements and what follows. Let's start out with the first one, the reduction of trade barriers for climate-related goods and services. This kind of reduction, of course, entails opportunities for climate change mitigation. But only 6% of all national climate contributions make a reference to reducing trade barriers in that way. For instance, Bahamas, St. Lucia, St. Vincent, and the Grenadines mentioned the reduction of their import duties on hybrid and electric cars. Some other countries seek to reduce trade barriers for the import of renewable energy equipment. So these are some of the elements that feature in the NDCs. This shows that there is still substantial potential for a stronger emphasis on this type of trade-related element in the NDCs going forward. The regulation of trade on climate grounds also entails opportunities to contribute to climate change mitigation, but at the same time also entails some risks of protectionist abuse. Around 11% of all climate contributions make a reference to regulating trade on climate grounds. For example, St. Lucia mentions a new levy to control importation of used vehicles. Eritrea mentions the restriction on import of used cars as part of their planned mitigation measures. Regulating timber trade also entails opportunities for climate protection and can stimulate trade in legally produced timber, for example, in the context of the EU FLECT approach. Only 3% of all climate contributions refer to regulating timber trade. And the countries with the biggest tropical rainforests do not explicitly refer to timber trade in their contributions, which shows that there's a lot of untapped potential in that context. Standards and labeling approaches. They might entail some risks due to potential market access challenges, especially for smaller producers in developing countries. At the same time, they generate opportunities to contribute to climate change mitigation, for example, by promoting transparency and awareness among producers and consumers. 9% of all contributions refer to standards and labeling approaches going forward. For example, Vietnam seeks to label energy-saving equipment and issue national standards, and Bahamas mentions the option to regulate motor vehicle emissions by setting and enforcing standards. Moving to border carbon adjustments, they entail opportunities for fighting carbon leakage and addressing competitive concerns, and we heard that these might become more relevant in light of the asymmetries that the NDCs entail. At the same time, they entail some risks of for protection of being abused for protectionist purposes. Currently, Mexico is the only country to explicitly put the possibility of border carbon adjustments on the table in their national climate contributions. But of course, this doesn't mean that others may not consider these kind of measures. Fossil fuel subsidy reform, of course, entails many opportunities for climate change mitigation. It also generates opportunities to eliminate a price-distorting practice. At the same time, and this was also discussed before, it's not easy to move forward on this issue. Around 6% of all climate contributions make an explicit reference to fossil fuel subsidy reform in the NDCs. For example, Brunei plans a review of fossil fuel subsidies to manage the increase in road traffic. Ethiopia and Burkina Faso seek to thereby enhance the generation and use of clean and renewable energy. So quite a few countries, when they mention fossil fuel subsidy reforms in their climate contributions, see that there are possible benefits and synergies with other policy fields. The same is true for Nigeria, which stresses the removal of consumer and producer subsidies for fossil fuels can help stabilize government budgets. So that's interesting that countries see this potential for synergies. Renewable energy, of course, entail a lot of opportunities for climate change mitigation. At the same time, more support for renewable energies and subsidy schemes can lead to some more tensions with the trade system. And we heard about the rising case of trade disputes that focus on renewable energy support. Virtually all climate contributions under the Paris Agreement mention renewable energy as a mitigation sector. And more than 50% of all of them refer to it as a priority, as a focus area. Technology transfer. Technology transfer can, of course, stimulate the diffusion and scale-up of climate-friendly technologies. At the same time, it can entail some controversial IPR debates in the TRIPS Agreement and beyond. A look at the INDCs shows that around 63% of all climate contributions make a reference to technology transfer and actually make part of their NDC implementation conditional on receiving technology transfer. And that's all the darkly shaded countries in the map, which underlines that technology transfer will be key going forward in order to make sure that the NDCs are implemented. International market mechanisms, and we heard a bit about them earlier. There are some open design questions and legal uncertainties going forward, but there are also a lot of opportunities for climate mitigation. Around 11% of all climate contributions entail an explicit rejection of the use of international market mechanisms, but 65% of the contributions indicate an explicit interest in using them. And also those who explicitly reject the use of international market mechanisms make use national market mechanisms and may be involved in linking their market mechanisms to other schemes. This is true, for example, for the EU. Since around 50% of all contributions are conditional upon access to international markets, these provisions are essential going forward. Response measures. Response measures can have unintended effects, including on international trade. A better understanding of response measures and who focuses on them can help to make sure that climate actions enhance rather than undermine sustainable development. That's why it's important to have a look at them. In the climate contributions, only 3% of them mention explicitly response measures. For example, Qatar underlines that its ecological human systems are vulnerable to the adverse impact of climate change as well as the impact of response measures due to its unique circumstances. So looking at the list of countries who include response measures in their NDCs, despite an apparent evolution in the UNFCCC response measures forum towards discussion about sustainable transition, the NDCs seem to show that the issue of response measures is still largely related to the interests of oil exporting economies. last but not least, co-benefits. So, of course, climate change mitigation measures can generate trade-related trade-offs, but they can also produce co-benefits. And it's interesting that quite a few countries actually mention them in their NDCs. 6% of climate contributions make some sort of reference to potential trade-related, specifically trade-related co-benefits. Many of these climate contributions refer to the potential of renewable energy development to foster exports of renewable energy and to reduce the import dependency on expensive fossil fuel imports, thereby also freeing up financial means in the public budget for other focal areas of sustainable development, including health or education. So going forward, it's interesting that many countries see a potential for benefits, co-benefits between trade-related and more climate-related measures. So what to make of this? I want to end with some brief takeaway messages. The first big takeaway message is there is a lot of untapped potential. That's the main takeaway. Yes, trade-related elements do feature prominently in climate contributions under the Paris Agreement, but direct references to making use of trade measures to foster climate protection specifically do not play a very large role, although they offer substantial opportunities for increasing the mutual supportiveness between trade and climate objectives. So there are many missed opportunities. For example, less than 1/4 of all countries' contributions include a trade element that is relevant for fostering mitigation. There's this considerable potential for putting a stronger emphasis on this type of trade-related measures, especially among the major emitters and exporters of embedded carbon. Interestingly, countries that are strongly susceptible to the impacts of climate change and highly dependent on trade, for example, small island development states and also members of AOSIS, seem to be more aware of the interlinkages between trade and climate and have included more trade elements in their climate contributions under the Paris Agreement. So going forward, I think there are three sets of options going forward that we should focus on. And the first set is fostering the mutual supportiveness of the trade and the climate regime. The increasing interactions between the trade and the climate regime in light of the NDCs and the Paris Agreement show that we have to pursue this path. And James Backus outlined some important specific recommendations for how to do that. The second set of options going forward is focusing on the future NDCs in the upcoming cycles and strengthening climate-friendly trade elements in these climate contributions. There's untapped potential of including more trade elements in future NDCs. Accordingly, there should be more awareness raised for trade opportunities in country contributions. And last but not least, there should be more guidance for NDC updates, and this guidance might also entail a reference to trade opportunities. The third approach to going forward is fostering the interaction and improving the transparency between the UNFCCC and the WTO. And James Backus also mentioned some elements going forward in that regard. There are two sub-elements in terms of this recommendation. First of all, climate change should feature more prominently in the Committee on Trade and Environment in the WTO. And last but not least, there should be better coordination and exchange of information on NDC implementation, more transparency, between existing bodies in the WTO and in the UNFCCC. And with this, let me close and thank again the organizers for putting together this panel and this workshop. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Clara. That's a great compliment to the presentations that we have heard today. And it opens a whole set of other questions, including on how to deepen and further the research that you have done, so to make it again, more useful and meaningful to particularly to the trade community, but also obviously to the UNFCCC. I'll pick up the last point that you made because I think it runs across all of the presentations, which is the need, the perceived need for active active interaction, so a very proactive approach to the interaction between the WTO and the UNFCCC. So much has been said about this for the past 20 years, if not more, and particularly in the past 10 years or so. And I wondered if we can get a bit more creative and perhaps bolder on that. One of the recommendations that Jean mentioned, which goes to the core of this, is organizing a joint session of, for instance, some of the or one of the committees on the UNFCCC that is touching upon some of these issues, and the WTO delegates. And in the absence of initiative from the institutions themselves, there's so much that institutions like ours can do. We will continue to try to foster this type of interaction. But it would probably be interesting to see more of this integration again of the discussion, because that's probably the only way to break the kind of the inefficiencies and all the difficulties that we had in the conversation. And to see more of that formalized and be more of an initiative that comes from the institutions themselves. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't discard that we would have to actually, we would be compelled to go that way, again, as we move into implementation of the Paris Agreement, as we see the biophysical impacts of climate change just pushing us more into action, and as again, countries move into implementation of their own NDCs and find that there is a need to resolve many of these issues. There is a pressure from the business community to provide certainty and so on. I'll open the floor. We have about a short 30 minutes for interaction, and I'll just ask you to please briefly introduce yourself as you make your remark or ask a question, but please don't limit yourself to questions, and rather comments and remarks, please.
Thank you very much. And let me say that this panel discussion has been very informative. And basically, we've learned a lot of the different aspects, some of which are rather worrying. I'll start with the last point you made about the interaction. We have had the word silos mentioned, and I believe something I have to say, and I could be forgiven, that there's this disconnect between not only WTO and IPCC, but also between WTO and the development world as such. There's a disconnect. There's not the interactive discussion of which you are talking. Well, part of it I'm saying, and I think the recommendation to bring the bodies together is a good one, but I think even before that, within individual countries, because what you find is that the interlocutors in the various fora from the countries themselves are not speaking the same language. If you are going to bring them together, then I think within the country, there's some work to be done in bringing the interlocutors on climate change and the interlocutors of trade together to prepare for such an interaction. Otherwise, we would see that we would come to the meeting and we would not have this sort of interaction which we require. So I'm just saying that most of these things, we always look at the institutions themselves. But I think we have to have an internal look within our countries if we want those to work. One thing which I was going to bring to the discussion in relation to climate change, of course, and I think the last intervention covered that, is from the perspective of developing least developed countries. I come from Sierra Leone, a least developed country. And whilst there is a goodwill to contribute to climate change, we have certain obstacles, which I think would need also to be addressed. And I think one was touched upon, the whole question of technology transfer. If you look at the question of energy, I mean, we would say that we are at a point where we are striving hard to develop and to contribute more to international trade. But then one important factor is energy. And if we are committing not to use fossil energy or to reduce our use of fossil energy, we are never going to get there, because even the renewable technology solutions that exist are either too expensive or indeed they are not solutions. If you look at solar photovoltaic, for instance, solar photovoltaic energy, I don't think we have the solution yet that is readily available to countries like mine to use them for the sort of industries that we need to be able to develop. So again, I think there are many issues which could be brought into the table. The interaction is essential. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll take other contributions at this stage. Yes, please.
Thank you.
Could you please just tell us who you are before you make your intervention?
Yeah, I'm Yifang. I'm the intern at the Trade and Environment Division at the WTO. And I have two questions for Mr. Bakas. And as you mentioned on the climate waiver, and when we speak about waiver, we have to be very cautious because of its potential influence on the existing legal mechanisms and legal obligations. So if we actually successfully create this waiver, and what if we create this precedent and there are other issues want to copy this? For example, there might be other environmental waivers. So how do we solve this kind of issue? And secondly, is it possible that we can address this issue in the existing system? For example, like Article 20, there was previously a case, India solar panel case, that they tried to use Article 20 and invoke the obligation under UNFCCC to create exception in the existing rules? And how do you see the flexibility in Article 20? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Peter, I think you had a...
Yes, thank you, Ricardo. Thank you for an excellent panel. Question, quantification.
You might tell her we're coming back to her.
Yes, I'm coming back to you on your question. I'm just going to collect a few. Yes. Yeah.
The issue of quantification came up a little bit. Peter Wooders, ISD, sorry. The issue of quantification came up in some of the discussions, and I was wondering, with respect to response measures in particular, you know, how much do we already know about how one country's actions will affect another, and is the sort of lack of information and lack of quantification a barrier to progress there, and you know, is that something we need to resolve as a community?
That's a critical issue. Thank you, Peter. Anybody else? Yes.
Thanks very much, Ricardo. Ho Lim, Director of Trade and Environment at WTO. I think there are very many interesting points that were made and the many challenges. And just a question and a comment. I think on the last slide from Carla Brandi about the interaction between the Committee on Trade and Environment or the interaction between WTO and UNFCCC, they're very important and valid points. But one puzzle that I have is that at least at the level of secretariat, between UNFCCC secretariat and WTO secretariat, there is this interaction and there is this communication, and we do it both in the committee itself with the representatives from UNFCCC, and when we can, we also do so at UNFCCC. However, at UNFCCC, we do find that we've never actually been invited to speak to the members in UNFCCC, and we are only ever invited to speak to the secretariat. So it's a puzzle. I don't have a solution, but just to say that the interactions between the secretariat is there, but of course you are pointing to something more, the interaction between the members. So, and I think that comes back again to the questions raised by Ambassador Choi and some of the other participants here. How do we actually solve that puzzle? So, basically, just a question, an easy one, I think.
Thank you, Hoglim. And actually, you just confirmed the points made. Anybody else? Yes, please.
Alex Castorin from ITC. Thank you very much to the panel for the very interesting presentations. I just had two short questions for responding really to the last presentation from Clara Brandi. So, when you mentioned that there's this very level of uptake of trade measures, is that a sort of question of glass half empty or glass half full? I mean, is it a question of lack of information, or is it more a sort of structural issue relating to those economies and why they're not implementing those policies? And secondly, do you have any, the panel have any broad reflections on whether post the Paris Agreement there are increased trade opportunities for developing countries and LDCs in the sort of green economy space? or is it just more of a business for larger emerging economies?
Thank you, Alex. Okay, unless there's anything else, I'll just go back to the panel, and given the time, that'll probably be the last iteration we have. So why don't we just start maybe in the order that we went, and just be feel free to respond or make remarks on any of the questions that were asked. So Jim, please.
Let me answer the questions that were posed to me personally by the very astute young woman with the Secretariat. The issue of whether granting a waiver on climate issues would open the door to other waivers is one we discussed at great length in our task force. You may recall that I stressed what we stressed in our report, which is the uniqueness of climate change. It was our view that the uniqueness of climate change as a challenge we're facing as a part of overall sustainable development merits a unique solution in the WTO. We chose a waiver rather than other proposals that would completely revise existing WTO rules, such as doing things that we tantamount to eliminating the like product distinction. We do not want to do that. I'm very careful to say that, and I reiterate that now. Would this lead to other waivers? It will lead to other waivers only if the WTO members agree. And there's a process there. There have been only a few waivers during the generation or so since we established the WTO. There will certainly be calls for other waivers. There are now in other areas of sustainable development, water, forests, biodiversity, more. It was our view on this task force that those issues can be dealt with under Article 20 of the GATT for the most part. Forests are exhaustible natural resources, for example, so of course is biodiversity, and so on. We were content with that, and that's as far as the task force went. But a last point I'd like to make that was not made by our task force but is my personal view is that we need to be more conscious of what the appellate body said in the shrimp turtle case back, I think, in 1998. And here I'm quoting shrimp turtle 1, so you can go back and look. I think it's paragraphs 152 and 153. And there, the appellate body looked at the original GATT, which talked in terms of the full use of the world's natural resources, and looked also at the preamble to the WTO agreement, the Marrakesh agreement, which talks instead of the optimal use of the world's resources and all of our trade and other economic endeavors, and says that this use should be in accordance with the objectives of sustainable development. The appellate body said there that this distinction is a distinction with a difference, and it should add color, shading, nuance to how the obligations that we currently have in the WTO agreement are seen, interpreted, and clarified. I don't think there's been much in the way of an opportunity for the appellate body in the years since 1998 to expand on that through issues that are raised in appeals. But I think it's important for the members of the WTO to begin to realize that consistent with what they themselves said in that preamble when we established the WTO, it's important to view current obligations consistently with the objective of sustainable development, and it's important in negotiating new obligations to do so as well. Thanks for the question.
Thank you. Andre, can we move to you?
Yeah, thanks, Ricardo. I think, indeed, very, very interesting. Actually, that would be quite interesting in some of the presentations because they are very revealing. P, Peter, your question on quantitative, there's very few real studies done on these things, especially on response measures, for argument's sake. We've done some. We called it at that time climate sustainable growth, and we did case studies on Poland, Maldives, Ghana, soda ash, and food labeling, working with your colleague at IISD. And I mean, one of the lessons that we learn is that it's a great qualitative discussion, but the lack of a framework for collecting information and the lack of modeling, ex post analysis, ex ante analysis, is really what the problem is. And as long as that problem continues, it's going to be very difficult to have a real objective discussion. So that's, I think you're, you know, bang on that. With respect to the gentleman from the talking about the UNFCCC secretariat and the WTO secretariat, I want to make it clear, I don't speak here in my capacity as facilitator of response measures. I speak on my personal capacity here. It's quite clear that in that room, there is a minority of views right now that would like to talk more about trade, but for a variety of reasons, they may be different, but nevertheless, coming together, most in the room would not want to talk about trade in response measures. And that would probably create problems of having the WTO coming in front of, you know, you see a lot of organizations, the IMO, ICAO, whether that is the reason or not, and, you know, how far the UNFCCC secretariat has gone or has not gone, I have no idea, but it would be interesting to test that mandate with the parties. So I think that it's what Ricardo said was extremely, when what has been said by a number of people in here, having a dialogue, and I think at this stage, probably the dialogue is going to be more difficult to be in a formalized. It's going to have to be informal until some of the you know, lack of trust is dispelled and you're beginning to build common language, both at the national level and the international level. And that, I think, it's something that is very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Andre. Ambassador Shoy?
Thank you. Briefly on the issue of the need to have more institutionalized interaction between WTO and the environmental community. I already explained why the WTO is hesitant to engage in this kind of interaction. To have a more systemic dialogue between the trade and the environmental community, I think one thing have to be clearer, which is how much we need measures, trade measures, that are inconsistent with the current WTO rules to implement Paris Agreement. Ms. Bardi showed us a list of possible trade-related actions that can help implement Paris Agreement. But unless how urgently or how broadly we need the international community need to take these measures that may be inconsistent with the current WTO rules to move toward Paris Agreement goals, then it's not going to be easy to get a broader support of the WTO members. With regard to the questions about possible business opportunities, I think it's obvious that liberalization of trade in environmental goods and services will be beneficial not only in trade aspects but also in environmental aspects. So in that sense, it was very unfortunate that we had very little progress not only in the Doha negotiations, in environmental negotiations, but also the plurilateral environmental goods negotiations have failed. I just hope that we will have a clearer view from the U.S. administration in the very near future and can resume the negotiations so that we can bring the negotiations to a successful conclusion, perhaps this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hanschrey. Dominique.
Yes, I want just to come back to the first remark. I think it's important because you understand that the concern of business is to keep the positive message for free trade. That's very important because we need free trade. And one part of the positive message is maybe, you are quite right, the diffusion, the free circulation of innovative technology for environmental aspects, because it's a kind of trade. It's better when it is included in a form of cooperation, of course, for less developed countries. But even if it is at a cost, normal cost or slight cost, it's a kind of trade. If we have barriers everywhere, we will not be able to spread innovation for reducing carbon footprint and so on and so on. So I think it's a positive message. Free trade, it is not only amount of goods, it's a caricature, huh, of course. But it is not only amounts of goods who are coming from outside with like some populistic opinions try to describe. It is not that at all. But we must find positive message to reassert the legitimacy of and the added value of free trade.
Clara?
Thank you. There is tremendous untapped potential to harness trade to help implement the NDCs and the Paris Agreement. So there are missed opportunities, and I think some of them are due to a lack of information, a lack of awareness, and that's why I underlined that there's a need to increase awareness of how trade can help to implement the NDCs and the targets they entail. But I think there's also a more structural dimension to this question in light of the fact that there were no guidelines for countries to prepare the INDCs in the run-up to Paris. And from that perspective, it's almost surprising, as you say, the glass is half full, perhaps. It's almost surprising that there are 22 NDCs that entail some sort of specific trade-related measures to foster mitigation. So there is potential for charting a positive path going forward. And at the same time, there's already quite a lot in there in the INDCs. If you're interested in more detailed analysis of these issues and recommendations building on these insights, you're welcome to look at the slides, which will be uploaded to the website of the event, and also to read the forthcoming paper with ICTSD that will feature the insights of the trade analysis of the climate contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Clara. Okay, well, I'm aware that this has been sort of a shower of information and research, analysis, perspectives. It's incredibly rich. It will take for us working on this questions sometime also to digest and to follow up. There are wonderful ideas that have come out also of the presentations, and I'd like to really thank you all for those very rich presentations, as well as Ambassador Joe Tyndall in New Zealand. One last word on this, that it's sort of related to Clara's last point, is that obviously governments have choices, as does business, when they undertake, for instance, to invest and develop infrastructure, which is, there's an enormous push right now in the international community on the SDGs as well as in the Paris Agreement to do so. But for example, if you were to build a wall, and we don't like walls, but of 1,000 kilometers, and you use concrete, it is estimated that you will release some 1.1 million tons of carbon dioxide if you follow sort of traditional conventional technologies. If you follow technologies that are actually carbon absorbent, and there's a Canadian company that has actually developed that, then you would actually relieve the atmosphere from about 1.2 million metric tons of emissions. And so again, there's the question of choice that countries have in how they pursue their agendas. That same with the national determined contributions. What we have right now in the Paris Agreement is the what I believe is a first iteration. We'll have to go through some of the work of the ad hoc working group, the discussions that are taking place right now, and we'll probably see a revision of those national determined contributions. And in those revisions, it would probably be good to then have much more information about how trade policies could enable, again, the transitions to low carbon. Low carbon should be about, it's all about, and climate action, it's about efficiency, it's about innovation, and therefore it's about higher productivity in economies, and that's why I also believe that, in a way, what we're talking about here is responding to the agenda of sustainability and inclusiveness. I make that point. Growing low carbon, to Alex and to ask that question is the only option going forward. And again, what we have to do here is ensure that we have a trade regulatory system that is enabling of that growth. With that, let me again thank you all. Ask you to join me in thanking the panelists, and thank the audience for your participation and your contributions.